expertise, your topics, our views. CSAP.NET and VB.NET are two languages that developed by Microsoft and it's wisely used for developing any Microsoft-based application. If you're coming from the Java or C++ background, CSAP.NET is much easier to understand. If you're coming from the Visual Basic, VB.NET is much easier to understand because their coding styles is mostly same. Microsoft has introduced various features on different version of the CSAP.NET. Let's discuss the feature of the CSAP.NET 6.0, which we can use for improving our way of writing the code. The code may be concise and in a readable format. It will also improve the productivity of the developers like us. First feature, let's discuss about this name of property. They have declared one this keyword, and this will provide you the name of the variable, property, or any member fields. So how we can use? So let's say we have one variable imply name, okay, and we need the name of this. Then say string name of him, and then if you pass this name, it will give you the name. You can pass the property also. You can pass the other member variables. Let's discuss another property, which is read only attributes. Read only auto attributes, auto property. Previously also read only keyword is there. You have to provide the read only keyword, and the difference between read only and constant is only read only can only assign the time of declaration as well as in constructor. But in C#6.0, if you have write some property with a getter only, say let's declare one property and it has only getter, it means that it's in a read only format. So either you can return here something return, or you can return any variable, return something. Some value like India, okay. In CSAP.NET 6.0, you can one more time assign the value here. Okay, here you can assign the value. So by default, if you have the getter, the property with having only getter value, not setter, you can assign the second time also here in the constructor. So it's automatically provide the read only property. Don't have to write the read only keyword. Okay. Third one, let's discuss the one more feature, which is widely used. If you heard about the null constraint, then there is one null conditional operator they have introduced. So how this looks like, we have to write something like this. It's used to check the nullable value of the property variable, and based upon the if the property variable is null, then you can assign the value. Let's take one example. So let's declare one more variable, a string, apply code, okay, and we have declared this null. Let's we have to use this imply code, and we have to check also that it should not be null. So we write something like result, and then we have to check this code. We have to pass this. If imply code is null, then what you have to pass? Either you have to have any variable which is already declared, you can directly pass. Okay, and this conditional operator can also be used for indexing. If you have any list and if you want to get the list value and we have to check this, you can write this something. If you write something like this, okay, we can able to check the nullable property also. This is also used to invoke the methods. Okay, this third one, which is important, in exception in C#6.0. They've introduced two widely used features. Let's discuss one by one. The first one, in exception part of the try catch block, in catch part where we catch the exception, we can write the condition. Okay, so it is known as the condition filter, exception filter. Okay, how we do this? In try block, we generally write the code which may throw the exception. Okay, we write all the code which may throw the exception. Okay, and in a code block, in a catch block, in a catch. We have to write the condition. How we write? Here we have to use the when, and then whatever condition you have, like something, you know, some equals or any condition you can write here. And based upon the condition, it will execute the catch block. If your condition is true, it will execute the catch block. If condition is false, your catch block will not be executed. Okay. The second feature is, it's known as await. If you have any async method, then you have to write the await, because once the method is executed, it will get the results. So in C#6.0, they have introduced the features like you can provide the await in a catch and finally block. So await can be provided in catch and finally block. In two blocks, we can write this. How we write this? Let's declare one method like public async, and then we have to pass its result, no, string test short. So we have write the try block where all the codes are there, and in a catch block in await, and then you can do the accept all the execution. In the finally block also you can use it. So these are the features which is not already there, they have introduced it. Okay. So this is the simple way to use this. There are two best feature of the exception that they have used. We have covered the auto property initializer, read only properties, name of. Okay, the third one is the expression. Previously we write the single code. Now they have introduced, we can write the expression also. Okay. So name, expression. How we use this? Let's take an example. We have two variable, public string. Okay. String first name. Okay. And then we have public or private string last name. Okay. Now we can directly declare the variable third one, public string full name. How we write? We write something like this. Then we have to keep this sign dollar, and then we can write something like first name, name, and then last name. This can be used in, you know, method overriding also. So directly we can write full name. It's read only. It gives you the first name and the last name. So we don't have to write another method and then in get we have to concatenate. We can directly write here. That's it, known as expression. So we have bodied functions and it's read only. Because it's read only, we are giving just the functions. So we are returning the combination of two functions. Okay. The third one also, one of the good feature. We heard about this. The way of initializing the collection, it's previously we in a curly braces we provide the data and make the collection. Now with the help of the indexer you can directly write this. Let's discuss in a small bit. So you can say this initialize collection in index base. Let's take one example. Create one dictionary. Dictionary is a key value pair. Okay. Let's see, it contains int and the string. Okay, it contains the roll number or the imply code. Let's say student roll number. Okay. How it declares? We generally write something like new dictionary and we pass the parameters. And then we write something like this. Here also we write some integer, let's say 1, and then is Aniket. If you have n number of code, you can write something like 2, Paris. Previously, it's done in this way. Now, the C#.NET has introduced the feature like you cannot write, you don't have to write this. You have to just simply write same. Let's say Control C and now we don't have to do this. We have to just write on index basis. Write something like this. Okay, we just simply write this the same way. So it's index based. We don't have to write something like this. So that's done. So this is the based upon the index that you can initialize the collection. So these are the few of the features which is introduced. Okay, thank you for watching the video. If you have not subscribed to the channel, please subscribe it. Thank you.